Four-wheel drive street cars like this Mitsubishi EVO behind me are becoming more and more popular to take to the drag strip, and we've seen the drag records fall over the years. However, one problem with the four-wheel drive strategy is that getting the car to launch consistently and reliably is incredibly tricky. Obviously, with all four wheels doing the driving, the problem is there's a lot of traction there, and particularly on a very sticky drag strip, this can be a problem. We generally see a lot of four-wheel drive drag cars either bog in when the driver sidesteps the clutch and go nowhere, or alternatively light up and wheel spin in third, but definitely the worst scenario is break some of the drivetrain components. We're here with Joe from Team Karam Racing to find out a little bit about what makes this Evo tick, and particularly, Joe, I want to start by talking about what I think is the worst kept secret in four-wheel drive drag racing, the clutch slipper. Can you talk us through what a clutch slipper is?
It is, mate. It's probably the almost hardest thing to get out of the hole with a four-wheel drive car. We run the Magnus slider on this car. It does help dampen the car on the initial hit. It's pretty much just riding the clutch out of the hole for you. That's the whole idea of it.
So let's go back a step. What we really want to do is we want to get the car moving off the start line without the engine bogging and without it just lighting up into wheel spin. So it's a real fine line, and some drivers have an uncanny knack of being able to manually slip the clutch just the right amount. But of course, everything's happening incredibly quickly, and as the power levels step up and the grip levels step up, this gets harder and harder to do. So when we look at professional levels of drag racing with the likes of Pro Stock, we have what is referred to as a slider clutch, which is a special clutch designed to slip. We can't fit one of these into the likes of an Evo, so this is the next best thing. So can you talk us through, you've talked about the Magnus Motorsport slipper valve, and how does that actually work? How does it install in the system, and what does it do?
Okay, we've basically just teed it into the between the clutch line. So so once you're ready to launch the car, so first gear, clutch in, pretty much get your lights and drop the clutch, and the valve actually takes over.
So the valve restricts the flow of that hydraulic fluid in the clutch system, so it physically forces the clutch to slip off the line?
That's it, mate. That's exactly what it does. It just dampens that initial load and just brings the pedal back up slowly, so it doesn't actually just bomb the tyres or bog or whatever and whatnot, yeah.
Now, one of the problems, of course, when you're doing this is you're forcing the clutch to slip. So you need a clutch in there that's capable of handling the torque the engine's producing, but also is able to withstand the heat that slipping produces. So what have you got in there for a clutch?
Now, I'm running the direct twin plate clutch on it. We've got, instead of the brass plates, we're running iron plates in it. So it does take a bit more of a belting, but you do take life out of it either way. So
on some of our cars running the same sort of system, we're running triple plate clutches and getting sort of 10 passes out of a set of clutch plates. So it's pretty brutal on the clutch, but that's the price you pay for consistent 60 foots. So what sort of life are you expecting out of this clutch?
Mate, if we can get, 20 runs out of a good hard 60 and 60 footing, I'm talking maybe 1.2, 1.3, 60 in it, it's good life out of that clutch, so.
I think as well, just for those who are watching this who really aren't familiar with drag racing, the 60 foot, that's kind of, in drag racing worlds, that's the measure of how well the car is getting out of the hole, how well it's launching. And there's a rough rule of thumb that gaining a tenth of a second at the 60 is basically worth 2/10 at the end of the strip. So that's the place we really want to focus our efforts, getting the car to 60 foot really quickly, and that's going to make your job in terms of getting a quick ET just so much easier. We've looked at the clutch system here, but of course there's a whole car around this. So let's go back a little bit and talk about what you've done here. So we can start with the engine combination. What are you running here?
Mate, it's a 2.2 Straker engine, 4G63, cast block steel. Pretty much, it's still streetable, the car. The car drives all day, every day, no problem. It makes about 650 kilowatt now on this 3584. We do have a bigger turbo going on in the near future.
I just want to go back to that as well, because this turbo for an all-out drag application is still what we consider relatively small, but you're kind of building up on this, aren't you? You're getting everything sorted on the smaller turbo, and it's still a 1,000 horsepower turbo, so it's no slouch, but for drag racing, there's going to limit the ETs, so then you're going to step up?
Definitely not a slouch, man. It still pumps, still goes very well. Still early days, the driver's still getting used to the whole concept of drag racing, shifting gears, using the sequential box, just getting his head around really the whole car. Once he's comfortable, mate, we'll give him more as he goes, so yeah.
Now, over the last few years in particular, we've seen more and more competitors move to billet blocks. These have sort of become the go-to, and definitely if you're up at the 2,000 plus horsepower level, they tend to become essential. At the power levels you're expecting with this, the cast is still fine?
Cast is fine, man. We've pushed others in the future, you know, well over 1,000 horsepower at the wheels. So, man, I've never had an issue so far, so we'll keep pushing until we do.
One of the big problems with any high boost turbo engine, and my own experience with the 4G63 is certainly no different, is head gasket integrity is key. And what I mean by this is we can make as much power as we want, provided we've got turbo in there, but at some point the cylinder pressure tends to actually physically lift the cylinder head off the block and allowing the combustion pressure to leak out into the cooling system. So how are you addressing that?
Mate, just with a copper head gasket and fire rings, and they just crush against the head.
So the fire rings, there's a variety of options there and materials and things that people refer to as fire rings. Can you get a little more specific on what you're running?
Yeah, what are they called?
Aluminium bronze?
Aluminium bronze.
So this has been something we've seen the likes of the Proline drag engines run as well.
Pretty basic, pretty straightforward. It works. Half-inch head studs. Pretty basic setup, man. Yeah.
When it comes to building a 4G63, there's a lot of options these days, and they have been for a while. There's 2 litre, 2.1, 2.4, 2.2. You can use the 63 and the 64 block, which have a different deck height and different bore diameter. Can you give us a rundown on why you've chosen the 63 block and the 2.2 stroker kit? Where do you see the sort of advantages and maybe disadvantages of that setup?
I mean, I like to keep it with the 63 block, reason being, bore size as well, keep the bore a bit tighter. The 64 just find that it's starting off at 86 mil, this one's starting on at 85, just a bit more integrity in the block. And I find that it makes, you know, just the amount of power, just the same amount of power, if not more.
Yeah, I think there's the old story that there's no replacement for displacement, but there's some truth in that, but when you're running a turbocharger, you can actually make up for a lot of displacement with a couple more PSI of boost. And you're right, the 64 block, particularly if you go to an oversize on that, you're ending up with a lot less material, particularly between cylinders and a thinner sleeve. So yeah, I think that makes a lot of sense. All right, talk us through the fuel system on the engine, because I've noticed already you've got a mechanical fuel pump running off the front of the exhaust cam. So where's the pros and cons of mechanical versus electric?
Mate, with the mechanical, obviously there's no voltage drop, no current issues, no power issues. It's just mechanical. Engine runs it. That's where we find, like, running, you know, 3 and 4 fuel pumps to run this car, it's becoming ridiculous. You know, your alternator can't keep up, you're running a dash, you're running all these electrical items in the car, and it's just too much power going on through the car. So we found that the mechanical system, it runs more efficient. The voltage is where you want it all the time. It backs it up back to back. If there's a voltage drop, you lose fuel pressure, none of that. So that goes all out the window, and the car's consistent. So
one of the problems with a mechanical fuel pump is we see that, particularly when you're trying to start the car at cranking speed, that they're not really operating fast enough to build up fuel pressure. So how are you dealing with that? Have you got an electric primer pump as well?
Yeah, we're running an 044 Bosch, just with a one-way valve. So it's just basically the FuelTech controls it just on the crank. So once you actually crank the car, the pump works, and then once it actually sees RPM, it turns off and the mechanical takes over.
We haven't actually touched on the type of fuel you're running, so let us know what you're doing there.
It's on E85.
Is there a reason you've gone E85 here rather than maybe stepping up to something like methanol?
Methanol is definitely on the cards. Right now, for where we're at, I think E85 is a good starting point, and then definitely going to methanol.
Well, with methanol, one of the problems is over pump gas, we need to run somewhere in the region of maybe 40% more fuel volume compared to pump gas, gasoline, in order to make the same sort of power. So that obviously puts demands on the fuel system. You've addressed that with the fuel pump. Talk us through the injectors. What are you running there?
I'm running Siemens 2400s. There's two rows on it now. However, it's only using the one on the 85. Once it's ready for meth, the injectors are ready to go. So.
And you'll run those through the FuelTech ECU in a staged manner, so just one set at idle, low RPM, low load, etc., and then bring the other ones in?
That's it, man. Stage them in. Once you seize 10 pounds, bring the next set in and go from there.
All right, so you've mentioned the FuelTech ECU. So let's dive into that a little bit. You've got that FuelTech ECU running the whole package. And where do you see some of the advantages of that FuelTech ECU? I know that it's become very, very popular in the US. We haven't seen it so much in maybe Australia and New Zealand just yet. It's starting to take off a little bit.
We just found if the FuelTech, the data logging is on point. As for just basic logging of the car and just in depth as well, you can get in there and the O2 closed loop control is phenomenal. The lambda control is you know crazy, works perfect all the time, backs it up. Where some other ECUs do tend to not give you the right reading when you really need it in the critical stages.
I think another thing that I hear from a lot of the teams with the full tube frame cars that are running FuelTech is the advantage of being able to control everything from one box, rather than a lot of people run a separate boost controller, a separate maybe ignition controller. You can do everything in one box with the FuelTech.
Yeah, well, it does need a nano box. It does need a peak and hold box to control the injectors. But pretty much the unit is a dash as well. So that's a bonus. So you don't have to run too many boxes, too many dash and can cables and whatnot to run everything. It's all into the dash itself. So dash is computer. It all works off the dash. It's all touchscreen as well if you want to.
That's actually a nice feature as well, because often as the track conditions change during the day, you might find yourself in the staging lanes and maybe there's an oil down or the weather conditions change and maybe the track hasn't quite got the grip. So rather than running for the laptop, you can actually make subtle changes to maybe your launch strategy straight from the dash.
Yep, yeah, correct. You can adjust it all from the ECU itself, the dash. It's got five different maps that you got. You know, you can change either if one you got a setting for lower boost or different fuel or whatnot you might want to run. So yeah.
In terms of boost control, that's another real key one. We've talked about getting a four-wheel drive car to initially get off the line, but a lot of this also comes down to torque management, which of course can be controlled with the boost pressure. So you talk us through how you're controlling boost.
This car runs a CO2 system. It's integrated within the FuelTech, so the FuelTech manages the boost controller on it. So right now it's set over speed. So it's got a clutch switch, so once you drops the clutch, the time actually starts clicking and starts counting. So within, you know, after the 60, so 1.5 seconds, so we dump all the boost back into it and bring it all in.
So you're dropping that boost out through first gear to just get the car to hook up initially and then driving the boost back in?
Yep, correct.
All right, so again, for our viewers who maybe aren't quite familiar with that term, CO2 boost control, and normally we run a conventional boost control system where the boost solenoid is supplying just the boost pressure from a charge pipe to the wastegate. So how does CO2 differ and where are the advantages?
CO2 is just basically a bottle full of CO2 gas. It's compressed, it's pressurized. So the gate actually, the advantages are that the wastegate shuts instantly. There's no there's no lag between waiting for manifold pressure or boost pressure to build up. Once the gate is shut, boost is up, it's gone. It's full, it's ready to go. So yeah.
I think as well with that, the CO2 is at a much higher pressure, regulated to a much higher pressure than what the boost pressure might be. Maybe you're running the CO2 at 80 PSI. So particularly I found with four-wheel drive drag cars, you need often, once you probably step this up as well, quite a wide range between the boost that you'll leave the line in first gear and what you'll run in the deep end, maybe fourth and fifth gear. So that gives you that flexibility, which you might not have with just normal boost control. Now, talking about the rest of the drivetrain, because that's obviously another key potential weakness for any four-wheel drive drag car. So what are you running there?
This one runs a five-speed Samsonas sequential gearbox. Still running the ACD transfer case.
So that's the active center differential for those not familiar with Mitsubishi.
Correct. In the rear, we're running a GDR R32 diff. Okay. We've made the conversion for it to fit into the EVOs. It's pretty much it, man. It's pretty straightforward, yeah.
Was that because you were breaking the factory differentials or some other advantage with the R32?
Just knowing that where the car's going to go and what we're going to do with it, and we're ready to go. So we don't want to wait for breakages, so it's good to go straight away, so yeah.
Look, from what you told me before in a previous build, much simpler than it is now. The car's already run a 1050 at 150 mile an hour, obviously just scraping the surface. And as you said, you've got a smaller turbo on it right now, just while the driver's getting up to speed and you're getting the package sorted. But certainly it's a beautiful build. It's a credit to all involved, and we look forward to seeing what the car can do, particularly once you step up the power. Thanks for the chat.
Cheers, mate. Thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.